Trude Eikebrokk. I am here to talk to you about our work towards sustainability in our open access journal publishing. I used to work for the OsloMet University Library as a team leader for digital services there. Now I am the head of knowledge management at secret research institution instead. But I am a librarian. I have been working with open access in my entire career. Just not that long, to be fair, but at least for the last 12 years that I've not been open access. Just to give you just to give you an overview of where I'm from, the Oslo Metropolitan University of Norway, it has about 2,200 employees and 20,000 students. We are the third largest university in Norway. Our roots are in vocational colleges. We educate teachers, nurses, engineers, librarians, and many more. The university library has four libraries around the campus, and there are around 80 employees. Not all of them librarians, but a lot of technical staff as well. We will also have our own section for multimedia, which is where our publishing services are based. And how did we end up as an open access publisher? Well, this was back in 2010. At this point in time, we were already running the institutional repository, so that was kind of our way into open access publishing. We were familiar with the concept of open access, but we didn't have an experience in actually publishing journals. But there were actually three journals already at OsloMet that were using the OJS software. They had been doing it for a while. There were probably one of those journals that John Lindsay was talking about yesterday that had been upgraded for years and years and years. That didn't have any technical support at all. And we also had the three journals that wanted to start up, but didn't have a platform. So they wanted something simple to start, but didn't require a lot of technical know-how. So that's where the library came into the picture. And we decided to run a publishing platform based on OJS. Because the existing journals were already familiar with that system. And everyone we talked to in Norway, they already used OGS as well, so it was quite a simple choice. And our goal was to make it easier for our departments to publish journals, and we wanted to offer the technical support that they needed, because that was what they were asking for at that point. And we also decided to provide the services for free. If the editor is an employee of OsloMet. We actually started out with if a member of the editorial team is an employee of OsloMet, then you will get a platform for free. But then we started seeing a suspicious number of journals that had one editorial member from OsloMet, which meant that they got the platform for free, so we had to actually change that rule. I think someone was playing the system there. So we launched our platform in 2011 and with six published journals. But then our goal of only offering technical support quickly changed. Something unexpected happened. Suddenly our team of two librarians that work in everything open access with regards to publishing a journal. And it turned out that librarians had perfect competencies for journal publishing. Our idea was just to run a platform to do the user support and the technical support, but we were now being asked on how to do peer review. How do I get indexed? How should the PDFs look for others to be able to cite them? How can I get DOIs? How can I get an ISSN number? How do I get approved in the Norwegian publishing system? And so on and so on and so on. The editors discovered that we already knew or were able to find out these things, so they kept asking harder and harder questions. And soon we were deeply involved with a few other journals on aspects such as ethics, copyrights, fair treatment of authors. We had quite a few difficult cases throughout the years. An example is when we had two authors that wanted to remove a third author from the paper because they had disagreements during the review process. And how do you handle that as a very new editor when it's your first time experience that sort of thing? And we also had one of the journals that being complained about. Someone felt that they had been cited unfairly in an article. So these were kind of the issues that we were facing and giving them advice about. So we quickly had to change service level from the pure technical stuff to a bit more. So now we a lot of the work that we will do is actually use support for the editor team, giving advice and guidance on everything about running a journal. And we will do stuff like provide those for them, we will do training for the editorial teams, we will attend editorial meetings if you are invited. We also try to every year have an annual meeting for editors so that they are able to sit in the same room and they can discuss issues that come up along the way, they can have difficult cases and so on. I will do advice and help with indexing and suitability, and we will help them find financing options. We remind them when there are grants that they can apply for, and give them advice on how they can get stable financial. And we also help them with delivery of statistics, downloads, stuff, and stuff when they are applying for grants. We've also been working kind of hard with changing the view of how they do digital publishing. We find that they have a very mindset from the traditional way of publishing. They are still thinking that, oh, the PDF, that's great. But we think that they are way too focused on the old way of reading a journal, where you start with the front page and then you read it through to the last page. Is PDF always the format that you should go to? There is an entire world of formats out there that are much better in lots of ways than PDFs. So we have developed our own workflow for publishing datasets now. We have been doing that for quite a few years. And talking to our editors that they need to get something a bit more accessible than PDFs out there. We also talk to them about how they do the publishing. A lot of the time they would store articles for months at a time and then publish six at once. So we'll try to get them to publish a bit more evenly throughout a year, if that's something that's and it makes more sense as you get a more stable workflow with people, just work through them as you get them and then publish them as soon as you can. And the author doesn't have to work with them either. And we're working with them that stuff. Do you really need to run a continuous page number for an entire issue? Can you just have EIDs? And we try to encourage them to, for example, film their abstracts instead of having just written abstract. You can have a video on the front page of the journal as well. And we will provide them with a platform, the storage, and the possibility to film authors. So we try to inspire them to do a bit more digital publishing instead. And then something happened again. We had a good thing going. We were running our 10 or so OsloMet journals. And then we started getting a lot of requests for price quotes from journals that were not belonging to the OsloMet. We got calls, we got emails, we got form letters, and we asked us how much do we need to pay to get into your platform. And then we had to kind of rethink our approach. Our focus had been only on the OsloMet University and the journals that were based there. But now we're forced to look a bit wider and how should we handle all of these requests coming? Should we say no? We're not part of our university. Should we consider them? Would it be fair to offer them the platform for this as well? Or should we do something else? And so we decided that we were going to open for requests on external journals. And we were going to charge for the service, but only enough to cover our own costs. With providing it. We also decided that we should offer free training for libraries and other institutions if they were going to publish journals as well. So if we get the option, you can either pay us and then we will publish it for you, or we can train your library and they can download OJS and help you for free. So that we would kind of give them the tools to do it themselves as well as providing a place for them to publish. We do no marketing at all. Every request that we get is just by word of mouth. We still get, I don't know, maybe one request each month. Not all of them pan out, but we will give a quote and then we'll see if they want to come to us or not. And right now we publish three journals apart from other universities, so university colleges. And I just wanted to give you a quick view of the open access publishing landscape in Norway. We have a few commercial publishers like OJS. They will publish 9 journals and also open access books. They're fairly new to the OE market. That's an old publisher with traditional, long traditional roots. They recently started to publish open access as well. And they have 9 journals. Getting to be a substantial publisher. Then we have the old Scandinavian University Press. They have 26 journals. I think they are the largest publisher of open access journals in the world. As you can see from the name, they started out as open by Norwegian universities. Then a couple of years, 20 years ago, I think, they became a commercial company as well. And then we have the universal publisher, and they are actually getting to be the largest part of the open access publishing in Norway. The University of Oslo published 19 journals. Also, Metropolitan University has 16. University of Tromsø has 12. I took out some student journals, some research journals, research report journals. University of Bergen has 11 journals. And then there are a lot of smaller publishers as well. Just by calculating these numbers, I think there are 67 journals published with OJS in Norway. That's quite a large amount. The commercial publishers, they will either charge a journal a yearly fee for the publication, or they will have an AEC. Whereas the university publishers will usually provide the platform for free, and a few of the journals have AECs. But as you can see, the Norwegian universities are actually a force to reckon with in the publication landscape in Norway, because we have the majority of the journals. We had to find a way to give a price for our services. And our goal was to give a fair pricing. We wanted to encourage competition in the Norwegian publishing landscape. We think that even in Norway, the commercial publishers are making a lot of money. They are not quite Elsevier yet, but they have enough. So we made the pricing models as fairly simple. We'll just take the labor costs, the social costs, and other expenses spent on running 50 journals, and divide it by 15. And our bottom line, price per journalist, is 7,200 euros. Fairly simple, right? But then we have journal number 16. So then we have to recalculate the same cost. We don't spend any more resources on journal number 16. So then we divide the same cost with 16 journals. And so we end up with a price set for new journals at 6,750 euros. It was interesting to compare to the cost of the University of Milan, which was around 6,000 euros, and the same price bracket. But the problem with this price model is that we will never reach zero, because we are only charging the new journals their proportion of the cost. We're not covering our old free journals in any way. Each new journal only pays for their part of the cost. So we really need to look at a new price model for this. Also, a few of our journals are looking into charging APCs, and that will change the equation, of course. There are a lot of bureaucratic issues with APCs in Norway, because we're in a large institution and we have to find a way to handle money somehow. We need to be placed in the account, and we have to have records and everything, so none of our journals have really wanted to look into that yet. But as you can see, we are moving towards sustainability with this model, but we will never reach it. So we definitely need to rethink something here. And we are also concerned with the fairness here. We are working a tightrope because we want to compete a little bit with the commercial publishers, but we don't want to outcompete them as well, because we both have really a fair market in a way. That's because the university or government will fund it after all, and it would be right to use government funds to outcompete commercial publishers. We can't use government funds to sustain a publishing service that does not cover its own costs. But at the same time, we need to change the publishing market. I think the publishers, they get an easy profit, and they do it, authors paid by government funding. So that's not right either. So we are considering looking into new way of doing this, maybe a national joint publishing platform that could sustain its own costs. It's a way to go. I think we are considering a project looking into that. And in Norway, we are already doing some collaborations on a national level, like establishing a meeting translation of OJS 3. So it would make sense to look further into collaborating. There's one thing that's certain, and this is a very slowly evolving publishing landscape, and I don't think we're going to reach a conclusion for quite a while yet. I'm not sure we're going to end up in a dying world.